Hi there, this is René Molenaar for GNS 3 Vault, and I want to show you how you can solve the OSPF troubleshooting lab. This is a fairly big lab, plenty of routers. We are running OSPF here. All of the routers are pre-configured, and we have a couple of errors in the configuration. So our goal is here to make sure our OSPF is going to work again. Okay, so what are we going to do? Let's take a look. First of all, we are not going to use show run. So we'll take a look at some of the show commands for OSPF, debug, stuff like that. And the first task that we have is this one. Router 1 was replaced. There was no recent config, so we got an older config, and now there's no OSPF adjacency between router 1, 2 and number 3. And we can only look at router 1. So let's see what we can find here. First of all, let's see if we have any neighbors. And you can see that we don't have any OSPF neighbors. Let's see if we have an IP address. We do. Show CDP neighbors. I don't see anything on the interface. Let's check out the interface that we have. It says encapsulation frame relay. So that's good. But I'm unable to ping router 2 or router number 3. So what we should do is start by checking our frame relay. And you can see that there is no frame relay mapping. But we do have some PVCs. So there are two virtual circuits and DLCI 102, that's for the one towards router 2. And this one is for the for router number 3. So what I'm going to do is create a couple of frame relay maps. Here we go. So you can see the mappings, and with a bit of luck we can ping the other side. So that's good. So I can ping the other side now. Still no OSPF neighbors. So let's do a show IP protocols. And what do we see here? First of all, routing for networks. There's nothing there. Passive interface, serial 0. That's not good. And also what I see here is incoming update filter list for all interfaces, number 13. Now let's take a look at that list, that access list that we have. And you can see there's a permit statement for one network. So here we see a couple of things that we have to fix. First of all, no passive interface. Routing. So if we look at this picture, router 1, I need to configure some network statements for area 0, which is the backbone area. There we go. Let's see what other interfaces that we have. There's a loopback here. I'm going to advertise this loopback as well in area 0. Here we go. Okay, so I entered some network commands. The passive interface is gone. We still have a filter, so let's get rid of that. No distribute list. Inbound, here we go. And let's do a show show IP or show IP protocols. Here we go, so it's gone now. Okay, so far so good. Still no OSPF neighbors. So let's do a little bit of debugging here. Debug OSPF packet, event, adjacency. So you can see that it is sending hellos. But here we find something. So what do we see here? Mismatched hello parameters. And it says that interval received 40, configured 36, and hello received 10, configured 9. So we have a mismatch with the hello and that interval. So let's change it. IP OSPF, that interval 40. And you can see that something is happening now, loading to full. But here we have an error, received database description from unknown neighbor. You can see that it's going from full to down again. So something is not good here. One of the things we need to check is the network command. So let me get rid of that debug. So what we see here, show IP OSPF interface. You can see that it says network type point to point. Okay, that's not good because we have a single subnet for our frame relay network. If it were point to point, you would have two different subnets for each spoke router. So I'm going to play around with the network command. And what we should do, we'll just try and start with the first one, the broadcast. And we'll see what happens. Okay, so something is happening. You can see that this neighbor stayed full. Router 2 is still busy. So let's do a show IP route. And you can see that we have learned the loopback of router number 3, which I can ping, so that's looking good. Let's see what happens with the router number 2. It seems to be stuck, or I'm just not patient enough, but let's do a reset. Okay, so router 2 is still stuck in state 2-way. The other one is in full. But what I see here, which is kind of interesting, you can see that router number 3 is full and it's the designated router. And router number 2 is stuck in 2-way or DR other. Now I need to make sure, let's take a look at the topology. I can only take a look at router 1, and I know that there are two virtual circuits from router 1 to number 2 and from 1 to router number 3, but I don't know if there is a PVC between router 2 and 3. And if there is no PVC between them, then it means that router 1 is the hub router, which also means that router 1 is supposed to be the designated router. So what I'm going to do is make sure that I change the priority, so router 1 will become the designated router. There we go. And I can do clear, and you can see that something is happening because router 2 is now, it went from loading to full. So we do have neighbors here. But I still only have an entry for this loopback. And I don't see the loopback of router 2. So what I'm going to do is make sure, because if you do a show IPO SPF neighbor, you can see that router number 3 is still the designated router. And the designated router in OSPF does not change unless you reboot your router or you clear the OSPF process. Now I don't have access to router number 2 or 3, so what I'm going to do is just shut them down and reload them like this. So here we go. Let's do a show IP OSPF neighbor. And you can see that router number 3 is now the backup designated router. Router 2 is still in exchange start. Let's see if it will show up or not. But by reloading those two routers, I'm sure that I am the designated router now. Okay, so both routers are full. And you can see both loopbacks here in the routing table. So this one and this one. Now I'm going to ping both of them and source it from my loopback. Because if I source it from my loopback, then I know that those two routers have learned about my loopback. And it seems to work, so this is looking good. So what else do we have? So we fixed this one. After fixing the problem router 1, you notice traffic from R1 to R2 uses the fast Ethernet link. All traffic should be sent through the serial interface. Okay, so I forgot this one, but between router 1 and 2 there's a fast Ethernet link and I didn't advertise it in OSPF yet. So you can see it's not here. So let's take a look which network that is. Should be this interface. Here we go. And you can see we have an adjacency here. Excellent. But we also see that we are now using the fast Ethernet link to get to those prefixes. Well, at least to this one. So what I'm going to do, because the task says that we need to use the fast Ethernet link as a backup, we can do this by just by increasing the cost. So fast Ethernet . Let's upgrade the cost a bit. Here we go. And now you can see that we are using the serial link again, because it has a lower cost. Alright, good. Now that's another one. So what else do we have? Area 51 seems to have problems. You can't get any of the OSPF adjacencies up. Make sure Area 51 has an adjacency between router 1, 4 and 5. So Area 51 has router 1, router 4 and router 5. Okay, so let's see what we have. First of all, this is the interface we need to look at. And I am not advertising it in OSPF. So that's the first thing we are going to do. Area 51, here we go. No, still nothing going on here. Let's see if we can ping the other routers. So I can ping router 4. I can ping router 5, so that's working. But we are still not getting any neighbors here. So let's start another debug there. And I'm going to take a look at adjacency, packet, event. So you can see that we are sending hellos. I'm sending hellos, but I don't see anything else. So I'm sending stuff over to the fast Ethernet link, but I'm not receiving anything. So could be a couple of things, but probably it's the network type. So what I'm going to do. So you can see it's configured as network type broadcast, which should be normal. But let's change it to non-broadcast. And I'm going to specify the neighbors myself. See if it makes any difference.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so it's stuck here at attempt, which means that this is not working. And instead of fooling around on router 1, I'm going to take a look at router 4 and 5, because the task says nothing about this route, so we can take a look at 4 and 5, what is going on. So let's take a look at router 5 first, and let's see where it is. Here we go. Let's check out a couple of things here. First of all, there's an IP address, and we can ping both routers, so I can ping router 1 and 4. Show IP protocols. There's nothing there, so let's configure OSPF. Here we go. Okay, that's better. So now you can see that I've got a neighbor here. Neighbor ID 4444. Which is this IP address. Let's go to router number 4. And let's see where I left it. Here we go. Show IP protocols. So what do we have here? Routing for networks. Now that seems to be okay. But what do we see here? Passive interface. Fast Ethernet 0. And that's not so good, because that's the interface we are supposed to be using. And also the loopback and VoIP 0.0, which I don't care about. But I'm going to disable passive interface. And now you can see that we have become a neighbor with router 5. What else do we see? OSPF detected duplicate router ID from this IP address, which is router 1. So it seems that router 4 and 1 have the same router ID. And you can see it here, router ID 4444. Now that's not okay, so we're going to change it. And you need to reset OSPF. Otherwise, it doesn't take into effect. Okay, so that's all good. So let's wait a bit till OSPF is done. But you can see that we have okay, so router 5 is okay. Let's take a look at the routing table here. Still nothing here, so let's wait a bit. There we go, that's better. Router 2, router 4. So now I'm getting some routes again. And you can see state full for router 4 and 5. So far so good, but I'm not receiving any of the loopbacks. Okay, so this is looking pretty good. On router 5 we have some OSPF routes. I can see the loopback of router 1, router 2, router number 3, 4. So this is looking good to me. Okay, so router 5 is not advertising its loopback. and I'm going to advertise it. Here we go. And now we see it here on router 1. Okay, so this seems to be okay. What else do we have? I don't see the loopback of router 4. But I do see it here on router 5. So why don't we see it on router number 1? That's a good question. Let's see what we have here. Outgoing update. There are no filters here. We fixed the router ID. Routing for networks. This one in area 51. And we see this address, this loopback, being advertised in area 0. Now if we take a look at our picture, you can see that router 4 is also in area 0. But there's no direct link between 4 and 1. So we have a discontinuous backbone area. So that's something we will have to fix. So let's take a look at what we have here. So our adjacency is okay now. We fixed that. Router 4 is the most powerful router in area 51. Make sure it becomes the DR. That's easy enough. You just need to reset . Let's change the priority. Clear OSPF. So if you change the priority, make sure you reload OSPF. So we did this, and then the next task says, okay, there used to be a link between R1 and R4, which failed. Okay, it's not there, huh? So that's why we have the discontinuous backbone area. Replacing the cable is impossible, so find another solution. And this is something we can do by using a virtual link. So I'm going to set up a virtual link between router 4 and router 1. If you create a virtual link, you specify the area you have to travel through, and then you specify the router ID. Not the IP address, but the router ID. Now it says OSPF adjacency, it's all good, loading full, loading done. So let's see what we have here in the routing table. And you can see that we have the loopback of router 4 here. Because we created a virtual link. Okay, so we fixed this one. What else do we have? With area 1 and 51 up, everything should be okay. However, when you look in the routing table of R1, you don't see all of the networks. For example, this one is not available. Well, we do have it now, but there were two things we had to do to fix it. The first one was the virtual link. And also router 4 had a passive interface command. So on to the next task. What do we have here? RIP networks are configured to be redistributed into OSPF. However, you don't see anything. You don't see any of the networks. behind R7. Okay, so R7, that's where we have RIP, and router 6 is supposed to do redistribution of RIP into OSPF. So let's have a look what we have there. First of all, I'm going to check router 7. So this one is running RIP and it's advertising those networks. So let's check router 6. And we can see a couple of RIP routes here. The next step would be check router. Okay, so let's have a look at router number 5. Because if router 6 is doing its job, then I should see those routes on number 5. But as you can see, there's nothing here. Let's see if there's a adjacency between 5 and 6. Nothing here. And that's probably because we don't have a network command. So that's something we have to fix. So between router 5 and router 6, that should be area 56. Okay. So let's set up area 56. What do we have on router 6? Okay, so here we can see that router 6 does have the correct network commands, but router 5 doesn't. Okay, so we got the correct network command. Still nothing happening. Let's see if we can ping the other side. And that's strange because we get a unreachable error. Let's see from router 6 if I can ping router 5. And that's not working. So let's check our interfaces here. So we got this interface, 56.6. And there's something funny going on. Since I can't ping anything. So the loopback is reachable, but I'm unable to ping my own interface here. So there's something funny going on with router 6 here. So let's see what we have. Now this seems all to be good to me. Let's check the IP information. We have this address, that's all okay. We can see that there's an inbound access list here. And this access list is only permitting the loopback of router 1. That's not a good idea. So let's get rid of that access list. That's better. So because of the access list, router 6 could send a ping towards router 5, but when router 5 was responding, it was being blocked by the access list. Okay, so now it's gone, so we are one step closer. So that's all cool, but we still don't have any OSPF neighbors. So let's see what we have here. Show IP protocols. No filter list. Router ID is okay. Routing for these networks, that's also okay. So this all seems to be okay. There's a network statement here. Also good. I don't have any problem sending a ping. Let's check the interface. Network type broadcast. Priority is 0, which means that router 5 cannot become the DR. Let's check router 6. This is interesting. So what do we see here? Priority 0, which means the router 5 nor 6 can become the DR. And that's not a good idea because this is a network type broadcast, which means that we have an election. So let's change it. Make sure one of those routers can become the DR. We see the timers here. Hello 10, dead 40. Seems to be the same on router 5. So this is all looking good now. Let's do a clear IP OSPF. Let's see if it makes any difference. Let's do a debug. Okay, so you can see that we are receiving something from router 5. And here we get some errors. So what does it say? Hello from 56.5, mismatched stub / transit area option bit. So it seems to be something with the area. So how can we find this out? So you can see router 5 number of areas, 2 normal. And let's see what we have here. If we look at router 6, here we go, number of areas 1, no normal, but a stub area. Here it says the same thing, it is a stub area. And if we look at the picture here, you can see that router 5 and 6 are in area 56, which is a not so stubby area. Which means that router 6 should be configured as a stub and router 5 should be configured as a not so stubby area. So what we're going to do is go to router 5 and say area 56 not so stubby area. There we go. Excellent. So if you do show IP protocols, you can see that it is now a not so stubby area. So let's see if this is making any difference. I'm making one small mistake here. Router 6 is a stub area, and I configured router 5 as a not so stubby area. So let's change it over here as well and turn it into a not so stubby area. I'm mixing it up because if you do a, for example, a totally stub area, so let's say you want area 56 to be a totally stub, then you need to make sure that router 5 has the command not so stubby area, no summary, but router 6 can just be a not so stubby area. So the no summary command is only something you need on the area border router. Okay, so let's see, both routers are now not so stubby area, so you can see something is going on here. So let's wait a bit and see if it makes a difference. And in the meantime, I can show you something else. Because if you look at this picture, area 56 is behind area 51. And all the areas should be directly connected to the backbone area. So in order to fix this, we have to create a virtual link, and you can configure this virtual link from router 5 to 1 or from 5 to 4. But I'm going to set it up between 1 and 5. Here we go. The virtual link is up. Let's do a clear OSPF. Let's wait a bit and see what happens between 5 and 6. If it is going to make any difference. Our virtual link is up. Let's wait a bit to see what happens between 5 and 6 here. Or perhaps better, let's start a debug. Because you never know what is going to show up here. So you can see it's looping. It's sending the DBD, the database description, retransmitting it, and we can see it says something about a smaller MTU. So let's check it. MTU 1100 bytes and router 6 has an MTU of 1500. So let's change it. And set it to 1500. There you go. Now we have an adjacency between 5 and 6. Great. So far so good. Show IP route. Okay, so we see a lot of stuff here on router 6. We can even read some of the loopbacks of the other routers. Excellent. So this seems to be okay now. So what else do we have? Okay, so the RIP networks. That's everything that starts with 172, 16 something. Let's have a look if we see them now. So if I do a show IP route on this one. On a router 5, I don't see any of those RIP routes. Let's do a show IP protocols. So what do we have here? OSPF, redistributing external routes from RIP. So RIP is being redistributed. But we have no idea what it is redistributing. So these are the routes we are talking about. Let's just type in those commands again, because we can't look it up in the running config. Redistribute subnets. See if it makes any difference. Ah, that's better. So I just typed in the redistribute command again, and now you can see all of those entries. So these are the RIP networks that we have. Let's see if we can ping them. And to be honest, I'm not sure which IP address it is. Let's check it out at router number 7. Okay, so this should be an address I can ping. But I'm unable to reach it. So let's look at router 7. Take a look at its routing table. And as you can see, there's nothing here. Router 7 is running RIP, but it's not learning any routes from router number 6. So let's take a look what is going on there. So I'm going to router 6, because probably I'm redistributing RIP into OSPF, but not the other way around. So what we're going to do is router RIP, redistribute OSPF, always specify a metric. Just pick something and we'll see if this makes any difference. Ah, there we go. So now we see all of those entries here. Okay, so that's better. And you can see that we can reach those loopbacks now. So redistribution seems to be working now. Alright, so far so good. What else do we have? Network engineer of R6 has configured summarization. However, you still see four different /24 networks. Configure the correct summary. Make sure you don't advertise whatever you don't have. So we're going to create a specific summary here. So how are we going to do this? Let's see what we have. So router 6 is where the magic will happen. If you do summarization, there are two different commands that we have. You have this one, so the area range command. And the other one is, now I have to think a bit, there's another command for it. We have the area range command, and we have, let me first check the area number, 56. I always suck at this because I forget it. It's not the range command, it's the, let's see what we have here. Let's think. Well, I always forget this one. Ah, here we go. Summary. Ah, it's easier than what I was thinking about. So you got the area range command and you got the summary address command. Now let's see which one we need. And okay, so these are the networks I want to create a summary for. So let's just give it a shot. And we want to create a summary as specific as possible. So 255 is a /24. This is a /23. And this is a /22. And the /22 will match those four networks that we have. So this is the correct summary, but let's see if I use the correct command or not. And yeah, this seems to be okay. So here you have it, 172.16.00/22. The other command that we have, using the range command, this is what you use when you want to do summarization from one area to another. And the summary address command is when you want to create a summary from redistributed routes. Excellent. So we got the summary. What else do we have? You notice that this network 6660 is advertised in OSPF as a /24. Make sure it's advertised as a /32 and don't play around with the subnet mask. So what can we do here? Let's check the, so you can see that we have a /24 on the interface, and this is something you just have to know. We can change the network type. Because this is what I want. I want it to be network type loopback. It's not even in the routing table. Because network type loopback for OSPF means that whatever you got on your whatever IP address you're using, it will always advertise it as a /32. But let's see what we have, because I'm advertising it in OSPF, but I'm not seeing this loopback. Ah, here we go. So here you got it, routing entry with the slash 32. Excellent. The last step, redistributed routes in OSPF have the same cost no matter which router you look at. Change it so the cost increases. Let's see if this is true. So over here it has a cost of 20. And the same thing here, cost of 20. And here it's also cost of 20. So the cost doesn't change, and that's because it's an external type 2. If we turn it into an external type 1, then the cost will increase. So we're going to change this on router 6. And I think I can do it over here. Metric type, turn it into a type 1 metric. And now you can see that we have a cost of 22 over here, a cost of 23 on this router, also 23. But you can see that the cost is increasing now because it's a external type 1. Excellent. And that's the last task that we had. So we are done here with the OSPF troubleshooting. I hope you enjoyed this. If you like this kind of lab, make sure you also try the, for example, the EIGRP troubleshooting one. And that's it. I hope you enjoyed this. Till next time, and if you want some more labs, make sure to check out gns3vault.com. Thanks for watching.